I've been editing videos with the M4 MacBook Air for about 6 months now, and in that time, I've grown to love so many aspects of this laptop. But there's also some stuff that's kind of annoying that I hope Apple will fix. So you can think of this video as a long-term 6-month review of the M4 MacBook Air, specifically from a video editing perspective. Also, for the sake of ethics, I want you to know this video is not paid or sponsored by Apple. I bought this laptop with my own money, and I don't really regret it. That said, this video does have a sponsor, and it's my friends at Zeppin, which, if you look at this other angle over here, look at that. Yeah, we got this angle. It's moving. What? So cool. I'll tell you more about them in a little bit. Let's start with what I love first, the size of this laptop. It is so small, so light, so thin. And after using compact PC laptops that were still powerful enough for video editing, like a Dell XPS or Precision Workstation, that is not a massively thick gaming desktop replacement, but still kind of large, transitioning to an ultra compact laptop like the MacBook Air that is still capable of editing any kind of video that I throw at it, 4K, 6K, 8K footage, it is still incredibly impressive and really a revelation for my productivity. For example, in the past, pre-MacBook Air, I would travel often on a plane to film weddings or attend conferences, etc., and I would sit back and watch a movie or two on the flight because my PC laptop was oftentimes too big to comfortably use in my seat. And in addition, the battery life was short enough that I could only get a couple of hours of work done anyways. Combine that with Windows laptops having battery power limitations that make them slower if they're not plugged in, which I've talked about extensively in other videos that I will link to down in the video description. And editing videos on a plane on Windows has really not been a good time. I wanted to be productive, but it was hard. But then here comes the M4 MacBook Air, and it's so small. It easily fits in my backpack, under the plane seat. I could pull it out, it turns on instantly, it fits on the tray table, it instantly connects to my AirPods, and in less than a minute, I can be editing a video at 36,000 feet with a very minimalist setup. Then we get to the second thing that I love about this laptop, the power that it has, specifically for video editing. Apple has been very upfront that with the M series of chips, they were very intentional about putting hardware video encoders and decoders on the chip, which Intel CPUs have kind of done this with QuickSync in the past, but typically video encoding and decoding is pushed off to a laptop graphics card from a company like Nvidia. And guess what? This not only makes the laptop more expensive because it needs a dedicated GPU for another company, it also drains the battery life faster because it has multiple components having to work together to encode or decode a video. In short, Apple has been able to make video encoding and decoding incredibly easy for these M series of chips to be able to do. And even if you're throwing 4K, 6K, 8K resolution video files at the hardware, it really doesn't even break a sweat because it's purpose-built to handle it. Prior to this laptop, my wife had an older Asus laptop that was very small, only a little bit bigger than this MacBook. But because it had such an anemic, weak processor and no dedicated graphics card, all that it was really good for was copying files from memory cards to an external hard drive when we were on a trip, which is what I personally used it for. But if I actually wanted to edit any videos on that trip, I had to bring a bigger laptop, or more than likely, just wait to edit those videos whenever I got home. Now, with this MacBook Air, this is the only laptop that I bring whenever I'm traveling. And I'm not just backing up footage to it, I'm editing on it too, and it's easily handling this editing without issue. But if there's one con, which we're gonna talk more about other dislikes that I have a bit later in this video, but one that I want to touch on now because I feel like it's very appropriate, is that while the actual editing experience on the M4 MacBook Air is very good, it is extremely fast, playing back clips, scrubbing through the timeline, making edits, etc. Whenever it comes time for you to export a video, regardless of whether it's in DaVinci Resolve or Premiere Pro, etc., that is where the MacBook Air reminds you that it is still an entry-level laptop from Apple without a fan and only one set of hardware encoders and decoders, because it will take a while to render a video. And if you're rendering a video in, say, Premiere Pro, where you can have Adobe Media Encoder render the video while you still edit videos in the background, you may start to notice some slowdowns while you edit. It's not a massive wait for things to render, to be clear, but you're still looking at waiting significantly longer than you would if you were editing on a MacBook Pro with an M4 Max chip or Mac Studio with, say, an M3 Ultra. Those chips have more hardware encoders and decoders and fans to keep them cooler, so they're going to be noticeably faster whenever you're rendering a video. In addition, those other laptops and desktops are not going to slow down whenever you are multitasking, rendering a video while also editing another video in Premiere Pro, for example. I have personally noticed with my M4 MacBook Air that when I was trying to play back multiple streams of 6K video while I was also rendering another 6K video in Media Encoder, that was when the laptop started to stutter and not play back video smoothly. So if you're a power user, which I consider myself to be, you're going to need to keep these multitasking limitations in mind with a laptop like this. And as long as you can work within these limitations, I think you'll be fine. Because personally, the size, performance, and price of this laptop is really hard to beat and is worth the limitations, in my opinion. But to be clear, I still want to see Apple improve on these limitations. Anyways, we have one more positive thing that I love about this laptop to talk about before we get into more negatives. And this last thing I love is the battery life. I've told this story before, but soon after I bought the laptop, I was on an international flight. I edited a video with this laptop for several hours. And whenever I took a break, I checked the battery life and it had dropped something like 11%. Literally went from 100% to 89%. And that was with me editing extensively in DaVinci Resolve for multiple hours. And my Windows laptops would have been warning me that they only had 20% of battery life remaining and would shut down soon. But the MacBook Air was like, oh, is that all? Just kept right on chugging. The battery life is truly exceptional with this laptop. What's great about a long-term review is that after having used this laptop for 6 months, I have noticed a negative that can affect your battery life. And that is that if you are using an external SSD with your laptop, which is something that I do relatively often, where if I have a very large video project, it will often not fit on the laptop's internal SSD. So I have to plug in an external SSD to edit from. You are going to notice a significant drop in battery life if you or editing video with an external SSD. And if you think about it, this isn't completely surprising. The laptop is not only going to have to power the SSD, but also handle reading and writing very large video files to and from it constantly that is going to use more power. But even I was surprised by how quickly the battery life on the MacBook Air dropped while editing videos from an SSD. Remember, with the internal SSD, I could edit videos for many hours and the battery life would only drop by 11%. But with an external SSD, it's more like a 50 or 60% drop. So in short, you're not looking at 12 to 18 hours of battery life when using an external SSD. You're looking at something like 6 to 8 by my estimate, which is still good, I would say, but not mind blowing. And I hope this will continue to improve in the future, especially if you're trying to edit a video all day on battery power. You can probably do that if you are using the internal SSD, but not if you're using an external. Anyways, I did promise you more negatives about this laptop, things that I disliked that I wanted to see improved with future generations of the MacBook Air. But first, I need to tell you about this super cool other angle of video that I've been recording and cutting to over here. I need to tell you about the sponsor of this video, Zeppin, and their extremely cool Evo D60 slider that I've been using in this video and that I'm planning on using in a lot of future videos going forward. The D60 is a motorized slider with pan functionality and is one of the easiest to use motorized sliders that I have ever tried. To set it up, all you have to do is grab the slider, which has a super rugged metal construction that is still lightweight. Power it either via USB Type-C or a Sony NPF battery. Mount your camera to the slider, point it in the direction of the subject that you want to film, set your start and end points, and that's it. Press the play button and the slider will immediately begin automatically moving between point A and B, panning the camera as it does, which allows you to get very precise, repeatable shots over and over again. You can even press the repeat button to have the slider repeat the movement indefinitely, which is how I've had it set up for this video. And you have a very useful dial that lets you control the speed of the slider. As you have seen throughout this video, I've been using the slider as a third angle for my YouTube videos that provides a very dramatic parallax movement that looks so cool. But as someone who loves to film motion time lapses, this slider unlocks another whole realm of possibilities, and I am so excited to use it more. You can check out the Zeppin Evo D60 in the description below. I know that you're going to absolutely love using it to elevate the shots in your videos like I do. Now, on to cons about the M4 MacBook Air. here. First, and closely tying into what we talked about earlier with an external SSD draining the battery of the laptop quickly, for full context, the only upgrade that I paid for with this M4 MacBook Air was to increase the storage from 256 gigs to 512 for $200. I will fully own this complaint. If I could go back, I totally should have bought at least 1 terabyte of internal storage, because I've lost count of the amount of times that I've had to copy files to this laptop and then copy them off to make room so I could actually edit from the internal SSD and not need to use an external SSD. To be clear though, upgrading from 256 gigabytes to 1 terabyte would have cost me another $400, and even now that I'm saying that I wish I had paid for the upgrade, it is still stupid to spend $400 on that amount of storage. Apple has always charged a premium to upgrade storage, and it's really annoying. I realize that this is a super thin laptop and it would not make sense really to add swappable storage because that would make it thicker and heavier, but at the same time, it hurts to spend that much money for such a small bump in storage. So let's compromise. Apple, if you are going to charge this much to upgrade the storage of your laptops, at least give us more than 256 gigabytes as the base storage option. Just like how iPhones took way too long to go from having a minimum of 64 gigabytes of storage to 128, and now we're finally seeing a minimum of 256 gigs, in my opinion, MacBooks are overdue for a minimum storage bump as well. Let's make it 512 gigs across the board at least, just like how you increase the minimum memory of the MacBook Air from 8 gigabytes to 16 gigabytes without increasing the price. Please do that for storage as well. It will make me not feel nearly as bad about spending another $200 to upgrade to 1 terabyte of storage. You can tell me whether you agree or disagree with me in the comments. Next, for dislikes. I would love to see the MacBook Air get more ports. I know this is supposed to be the entry-level laptop, but as we've already talked about in this video, it is still really powerful. And as somebody that does not want to upgrade to a MacBook Pro, they'll be larger and heavier, I would love if Apple was able to squeeze even one more USB Type-C port on the other side of this laptop. That would be so helpful for so many things. Copying files from one external drive to another, which I do all the time. Charging the laptop whenever the cord doesn't stretch all the way over to the left side. Confession, I also lost my MagSafe charging cord within the first month of owning this laptop. I accidentally left it in a hotel room. It's gone forever and I haven't bought another. So I'm already using one USB Type-C port to charge the laptop. I need more ports, Apple. I'm not asking for an SD card reader slot or an HDMI port. And please don't put some micro SD card slot on it like other PC laptop manufacturers have been doing lately. Who's using micro SD? Why are we putting that on a laptop? It's useless for 99% of people. Come on, Apple. Video editors will really appreciate more ports. Otherwise, though, as I think I've shown you throughout this long-term review, the M4 MacBook Air has been an absolutely stellar, ultra-compact, yet still powerful laptop that has been my go-to for editing videos while traveling. And while it has its flaws, like any piece of tech, I have not regretted purchasing it at all, and it's hard for me to imagine traveling and editing videos without it at this point. That said, there is still stuff that I would love to see Apple working on, like more hardware encoders and decoders on the chip for faster video rendering, a higher base amount of storage, and maybe another USB-C port or two. These are things that I'm going to be looking for whenever the M5 MacBook Air is released, and you can let me know if you would like to see me make a review of that laptop and any other improvements that you'd like to see to this laptop as well. Thanks so much for watching. I'll link to my Mac buyer's guides down in the video description, as well as my Edit Videos Like a Pro guide that's going to show you some of my most advanced video editing techniques completely for free. Please like this video if you enjoyed it, subscribe if you loved it, and have a great day.